was quite very reluctant to go through the process of biopsy, which is a procedure that we do to access the piece of tissue that we analyze in order to understand exactly what type of cancer this was. He took us a back and forth conversation with him until eventually in June 2021, he accepted to undergo that procedure. He successfully did a lung biopsy along with a bone marrow biopsy at the Cancer Institute. The analysis thereafter confirmed that it was actually lung cancer, and particularly a subtype called non-small cell lung cancer. Non-small cell lung cancer possibly constitutes over 80 to 90% subtype of cancer in the lung. There is what we call a small cell lung cancer, but the non-small cell is the commonest, and it's not associated with smoking. We found out Honorable had never smoked before. Upon that confirmation, we had a tumor board discussion, as it's a tradition in oncology, that all patients must be discussed by a group of well-experienced doctors to determine what would be the best available therapy. We had a discussion, and it was agreed by a team of doctors that we offer Honorable a form of treatment called targeted therapy, precision medicine, which is less toxic compared to the ordinary chemotherapy that we often give in some circumstances. He did very well, His Excellency. On June 2021 through to June 2022 this year, Honorable General Tumwiine went back to his normal life. He was able to attend functions. He spent much of his time in Kazo in the village. Together with him, he told me, "Omoding, my brother, I think village is a very good place." And he said, "Why don't we call this village therapy? We should experiment and have all our patients, whenever you treat them, send them to the village, let them stay and experience the beauty of the countryside." His Excellency, it was until June 2022, a year after Honorable General Tumwiine called us. And this time around, he was not well. He had developed back pain that had worsened. He had developed weakness in his lower limbs. We were quick to review him again. We repeated a couple of images, MRI scans, to look through his back. We did MRIs of his chest to determine if we were dealing with progressive disease. It is amazing, though, that the findings out of these radiological evaluations were keeping with stable disease. It seemed we were still beating the disease at that point of time. We considered him for what we call consolidative radiation, those particular spots on his spine, the primary, to achieve more additional effect or control over disease, which he did with quite very good results. The pains dissolved, the weakness got better, we're all happy. Until late July of 2022, when we received a call from Honorable Tumwiine. This time around, he had developed challenges with passage of urine. And we're quite concerned. Sooner before that, he had developed challenges in his bowel movements as well. We did a re-evaluation in end of July, and it became very evident to us that we had actually now developed progressive disease. Not only was it only in his lung and lymph nodes and bones, but now it had actually spread to his liver, as well as the abdominal wall and part of the adrenal glands. We again constituted a team and had a discussion on what would be the best way forward. Of course, at this point of time, we were very wary that we are dealing with resistant disease. Also, had actually given him the very best first-line treatment, which could be given anywhere in the world for lung cancer. We agreed in principle that we are now dealing with what we call a visceral crisis because of now the liver, the adrenals were involved. We agreed to provide and offer him a form of treatment that is meant to support and help his immune system fight the cancer, what we call immunotherapy, which he successfully administered to Honorable Jim Reilly. However, it was a spiral down of events soon after that. The obstruction became a challenge. We did a couple of evaluations. We called in the gastrointestinal surgeon to help. Colonoscopy was done to try to look in, but it was quite a phenomenal challenge to help with the obstruction. Soon later, he began to accumulate a lot of fluid in the abdomen and in the lungs. It was at that time that it was agreed in consultation with our senior colleague, Professor Godfrey Ferricololet, who is quite a renowned gastroenterologist in our East African region. Could he weigh in? And I spoke to him and he said, could you have Honorable come over to Nairobi? To be honest, His Excellency, it was again not an easy one to convince Honorable General Eli to go to Nairobi. He was very patriotic. He challenged us a number of times. We must have the capability to do and to handle and treat me in Uganda. Going out was not his option. He was very much challenged, but later on, he agreed to go out. When he arrived in Nairobi, as Enos Musimi has mentioned, Professor Godfrey Lole successfully was able to help with the obstruction. But soon after that, it was a spiral of events. He developed what we call sepsis, which is really an overwhelming infection with a drop in his blood pressure, difficulty in breathing, and eventually developed kidney failure. On the 25th of August, around 6:45, he got a cardiac arrest and he could not be revived. His Excellency, we lost the battle then. May God comfort the family of Honorable Eli Tumwiine. May God comfort us all Ugandans who have seen the great good of the life we lived by Honorable General Eli Tumwiine. I want to thank His Excellency the President, the family of Honorable General Eli Tumwiine, the Directorate of the UPDF Medical Services, the medical teams that did their best. May his soul rest in eternal peace for both of our country.
Your Excellency, if breach of agreements will deny us going to heaven, many of us will not go. We agree with people in the summary.